Thank you very much. And I have to say, Dr. Goose, that you inspired me. However, if I were sitting out there, I'd be worried that I might be replaced by a toilet. But not if you go into surgery. You notice that that Japanese toilet doesn't do surgery. So, which reminds me of there's a million stories about the difference between a physician and a surgeon, between Dr. Goots as a physician and me as a surgeon. But the one I like was one I heard when I was in London as a medical student. And I was invited by my professor to the Royal College of Surgeons. The speaker was the president of the Royal College of Physicians. And he was telling the surgeons the difference between a surgeon and a physician. And he said in London, you know, where they have roundabouts, that a physician roars into the roundabout, driven by his chauffeur in his Bentley, circles the roundabout three times, carefully studying every exit, finally chooses the correct exit, proceeds down the correct exit, gets halfway down the correct exit, turns around, comes back, double checks the sign to be sure that it's the correct exit from the roundabout and proceeds down the right road. The surgeon, he said, on the other hand, roars into the roundabout, driving his own Jaguar, immediately goes down the wrong road, gets halfway down the wrong road, realizes it's the wrong road, turns around, goes back, cuts down the sign, and proceeds down the wrong road. So you're going to hear, interestingly, a very similar message from me, and you'll see why. One of the things I wanted to comment on is that in your mission statement, I saw URM. Everybody know what that stands for? I read your mission statement. You should read it because it says underrepresented in medicine. And based on what I've seen, what I've heard, and what I know about you, I think you should change your mission statement. And it should be ultimately represented in medicine. And that's going to be the essence of what I want to say. 1 week ago today, I became the 93rd president of the American College of Surgeons in that academic regalia, and I was given this medal. I think some of you who I passed in the hallway thought, boy, that's surgical ostentatious behavior to wear his medal. But you know why I wore the medal is that I was told when I became president of the American College of Surgeons and given this medal that you are to wear that to the most important occasions in which you are asked to speak this next year. And as president of the college, I'll be traveling around the world. I leave for Edinburgh in 2 weeks, and then I go to London and then with my wife, who's a pediatrician. And then we go to Japan and Auckland, New Zealand, and Puerto Rico, and India, and Japan, et cetera, et cetera. And I'll be speaking, just as Dr. Goose has at the meeting she's gone to, I'll be speaking to the surgical leaders of the world, some of the most important people who have been my heroes in surgery. But you know what? I'm not going to tell them anything they don't know. And I'm not going to influence them or change their career. And for that reason, without being at all gratuitous, I will say to you that I think that this lecture that I'm honored to give this morning will be more important than anything else I do the rest of the year. If I'm successful, if I succeed in inspiring one of you or two of you or three of you to continue to persevere what we know is a difficult road to hoe to become a physician. If you are interested in surgery, how many are interested in surgery? Wow. I think it was 99%. If you're interested in surgery, I would recommend this book. I'm going to be recommending a few books today. I love books. I love to read. But this is A Century of Surgeons and Surgery, written specifically because I have the honor of becoming president of the American College of Surgeons on the eve of our centennial year, our 100th anniversary. We were founded in 1913. And this is a wonderful history. And mostly what I want you to know, whether you're going into surgery or not, is read about the men, and I say the men because they were all men in 1913 when I look at the pictures, and I'm going to tell you why that's changed, as you've already heard. But they were courageous. They had the courage, they had the vision to really challenge what was going on in American hospitals at that time. The standards were terrible. You'd go to a hospital, you didn't know if you would live or die. You were better off sometimes not to go to the hospital. The Institute of Medicine tells us today that that may still be true today, and we still have challenges. There was fee splitting. Surgeons split their fees with people who referred patients. So there were all kinds of things wrong, but it took a few courageous people to stand up and make a change, and that's very well documented in this. Well, as you've said, one of my jobs last week was to give my presidential address, and I was addressing a group of young fellows, the newest fellows to the American College of Surgeons, and I decided, having read the previous presidential addresses, that nobody had ever really spoken to them. They had written an erudite academic piece to be published, and I decided I would speak to them, and I also wanted to know who they were, and I also knew they didn't know who they were, because they come together, they become fellows of the American College of Surgeons, and they go all over the world, and they'll never meet again other than that very elegant ceremony that night with robes and grandeur and singing the national anthem and O Canada, because we are the College of Surgeons of the United States and Canada in French and English. And so I did a survey, and the college said, no, you can't do a survey. There's no time. We don't know who they are until July, and you're giving your lecture at the end of September. There won't. I said, no, I've used SurveyMonkey before, and I'm going to do it. And they said, okay, but you can't ask things like ethnicity and things like that. And I said, but that's precisely what I want to know. So I'm going to. So I did. So I did a survey of the fellows. And when I started my presidential address, I'm almost tempted to do it now, except I suspect many of you, and particularly you're in groups from San Diego and Northern California, you know one another. But I said to them, I'm going to stop now, and I want you to introduce yourself to the person on your left and to the person on your right. And it's likely, and then I stopped and waited, and there was this buzz, and everybody thought, what the heck is he doing? You know, this isn't what you do in a presidential address. And there was this buzz of people talking, and I finally had to interrupt them and say, okay, it's likely that you may have met the future president of the American College of Surgeons in about 30 years, which is about how long it takes, or you may be that person yourself. But now I'm going to tell you who you are. There were 1,377. Have any of you ever done a SurveyMonkey survey? You know what the statisticians tell us, you know, that if you get a 50% response rate, you know, you're doing well. I had over 1,100 of these new fellows respond to my survey. And what I learned, not surprisingly, but nobody had ever had the data, they were incredibly diverse, as we've just heard from Dr. Goose, that we need a diverse population of physicians in the 21st century because diversity is key to solving our problems. They were diverse in gender, ethnicity, their specialty. They were diverse in where they practiced, mostly urban and suburban, but 7% were in rural areas. More importantly, fellows came from around the world, across the globe, from 47 different countries and every continent. They were born in 16 different parts of the world. And then I asked about I had just one open question, which they said, you can't ask an open question because you can't collate those data, it won't be statistically. I said, I don't care if it's statistically significant. I want to ask them, what is something I should know about you as the new fellows, about your character, about your identity? And the answers were fabulous. I can't share all of them. But these were some of the themes that came out that I suspect if I had surveyed you, I would see the same things based on the brief sample size of people I've had a chance to talk to. It would be about caring. It would be about ambition and sense of humor and hobbies and some athletes, I'm sure, and some actors and some musicians and people interested in learning and growing. And I was so impressed with the character collectively of that new class of fellows. And as I thought about today, I suspect you look up there and you would see what word you may have put up. This is the distribution of surgeons of our chapters around the world, as you see. And these are all of the countries represented. There was ethnic diversity. A third of the North Americans, because I have to be careful that I don't just say the United States, because it's the United States and Canada, had parents born elsewhere. They were born in Asia, Middle East, Africa, Europe, and Latin America. See, I thought that was better. I wasn't interested in skin color per se, but I was interested in ethnicity. And initially I said, where were you born? But my wife, being much smarter than I, whose mother you'll hear about, was born in Costa Rica, she said, Brent, I was born in the United States. Ask them where their parents were born. Then you'll have a sense of the diversity regarding ethnicity. So I'm going to ask you, how many people sitting here's parents were born somewhere other than the United States? Wow. Wow. I wish I do. I have my camera. I'm preparing my next presidential address. I really, okay, everybody whose parents were born in another country, raise their hand. Okay, thank you. The other thing that was absolutely remarkable was, and this may not seem so to you because you've just heard 50%, going on 50% of medical school classes today are women. But of these fellows now, they've been out about 4 or 5 years, 22% of them were women. What I compared that with was when I became a fellow of the American College of Surgeons in 1976, 1% of my class were women. So that leads me to my first story. And I want to introduce you to Anita Figueiredo. Anita. Anita died a few years ago, and we lost a great woman, a great surgeon. I told the surgeons that night that I may be unique as the only person whose first surgical partner was their mother-in-law. Anita Figueiredo was my mother-in-law. She had been born in Costa Rica from an educated family. Father was a lawyer, but she wanted to be a doctor at age 5. We don't know, well, we now do know all the story, but she wanted to be a doctor. There was no medical school in Costa Rica. Her mother, Lita, took her to New York through Ellis Island. Her mother spoke no English, took this little girl specifically to launch her education. Lita spoke no English. She worked in the sweatshops of Spanish Harlem in the garment industry, sent this little girl to school, where she went to the Long Island College of Medicine. She wanted to be a surgeon, but never mind medical school, which she had succeeded getting in. There were no women being taken. And then something happened that changed everything for her in surgery in 1940. What do you think that was? World War II. And when World War II erupted, the world was turned upside down, and virtually all of the men went to war. And Memorial Cancer Hospital, which you today might know as Memorial Sloan Kettering, was forced to take two women, just like your physics class. And Anita Figueiredo was one of those two women. And she, too, was incredibly successful. She went on, married a pediatrician, Bill Doyle. They moved to San Diego. She became the first woman surgeon in San Diego. She had 9 children, never quit operating. They didn't ask her the question if she was going to get married and if she was going to have children. She said it had more to do with her religion than a love of children, the fact that she had 9 children. And thank goodness, my wife being her second. And then she was incredible in so many ways, but one of her lifelong friends was Mother Teresa of Calcutta, who became a friend of our family because whenever Mother Teresa was in the United States, she would come and visit our family, and Anita would go to Calcutta and visit her. But here's what they said in the Look magazine article about this beautiful young surgeon, Anita Figueredo, 1942. Wartime reduces the odds against her in a field rife with anti-feminine prejudice. She was asked, did you ever feel discriminated against? And this was the secret of her success. She said, oh no, or at least I never noticed it if anybody was discriminating because I was a woman. I never noticed, and if they did, I felt sorry for them. And if you want to read about it, my wife did 20 years of research because she wanted to know who is this incredible woman, Anita Figueredo. So she wrote her biography, which won the best biography in San Diego in 2010, A Trail of Light. And then because she was from Costa Rica and they wanted it in Costa Rica, and many Spanish-speaking physicians around the United States wanted it in Spanish, she translated it into Spanish to Una Estela Luminosa. So it is in both, and if you're interested, it is on Amazon.com. So this is about diversity, and I just want to say a word about collective intelligence. There is a center at the Massachusetts Institute of Technology around collective intelligence. And they've done some very sophisticated work. And first of all, they point out for a group to be successful, like you, it wasn't about medicine and healthcare, it was more about other things, but they said if you want to have a group that's successful, first of all, it has nothing to do with the intelligence of the leader. There's no statistical correlation with the intelligence of the leader. What it has everything to do with is the emotional intelligence of the group, and they concluded that the emotional intelligence of a group is strongly correlated with the number of women in the group. That is the good news of where we're going for you women. Now, how many men are there in the audience? Good. Let's not be intimidated. We can have emotional intelligence too, but make sure you sit next to a woman in those critical classes because it's likely that the DNA will favor her over you. I was interested, Dr. Goods, how you became a doctor. You had a burn. And I suspect many of us here today had a similar story. I did. I needed a good doctor when I was 8 years old, and thank God my parents found one. And that's Rulin Howe on the left. I had had abdominal pain and vomiting, was misdiagnosed, had an appendectomy. That wasn't the problem. That surgeon told my father to take me to a psychiatrist. My father fortunately didn't do that. He took me to Dr. Howe, looked across his waiting room, recognized a sick boy, got an IVP, saw that I had a blockage of my kidney by an anomalous renal artery, referred me to Dr. George Pfister, a urologist who operated on me within 2 days, and truly saved my childhood. Those two men were my initial inspiration because nobody in my family had gone to college. Certainly nobody had gone to medical school. They were homesteading cattle ranchers, my father a locomotive engineer on the Union Pacific Railroad. He ran the big steam engines, and that was the ultimate. That's what I thought I would do someday. And then something else happened. The reason I not only wanted to be a doctor, but I wanted to be a surgeon was this great train wreck in 1951, just outside of Evanston, Wyoming, the town of 3,000 where I was born. And the streamliners, the big, great passenger trains at that time, one would leave Los Angeles, one would leave San Francisco, and they would go to Chicago. Ironically, that year, the American College of Surgeons met in San Francisco, and many of the surgeons and their families boarded the city of San Francisco and were headed back to Chicago. The city of Los Angeles was stopped at a red light just outside of Evanston, Wyoming, in the worst blizzard of the year. The block signal was covered, and it slammed into the back of the city of San Francisco, into the back of the city of Los Angeles, and multiple people were killed. But out of the wreckage climbed some of these surgeons who had just been to the meeting in San Francisco. And the Scudder oration that year, an oration I gave 2 years ago, was on, Dr. Goose, the treatment of fractures. And they crawled out of the wreckage, they got the orange crates, they broke, it sounded like your experience in the jungles of Peru, and they took the crates and they started splinting fractures and helping the local primary care physicians who would have been totally overwhelmed. And you see people standing and looking at the wreckage. I was in that group of people with my father, who thank God was not the engineer on that train. And I knew then that I wanted to take care of people like that. And I was on my way. I then went to San Francisco to medical school, first time I'd been out of Wyoming. I was a river guide all through college and then medical school. This was my other mentor, Dr. J. Engelbert Dumphy, who had also been president of the American College of Surgeons. And he told me, Brent, get involved in the American College of Surgeons. So I was in San Francisco in the 60s. Now, some of you are not old enough to probably appreciate that if you remember San Francisco in the 60s, it said, you weren't there. Some of you have parents who've maybe told you what to say. But I can tell you, we have two sons in their late 30s and a daughter in her late 20s. And at least for our sons, they think the only thing I've ever done in my career that was really significant is that I used to take care of the Grateful Dead at the emergency room of the San Francisco General Hospital, which you see circled. There were protests, there were peace marches, Vietnam War was raging. LBJ was the beleaguered president of this country. But it was an absolutely incredible time to be in that city, and particularly for a boy from Wyoming, going to medical school and doing my surgical training there. But this is the second story I want to share with you, is that good things can happen even in a bad situation. In this case, when I was a second-year surgical resident at the VA hospital in San Francisco, I heard a code blue, and I rushed to the code blue, and it was already in progress, and they had intubated a lady vet, and they were bagging her with an Ambu bag, and every time they bagged her, she got worse. And being a surgical resident, I recognized, fortunately, a tension pneumothorax. And we always carried a 13-gauge needle. I knew what to do. Claire knows, an EMT. I plunged it into her second intercostal space above the rib so I didn't hit the artery. And choo, the air escaped. And today, my wife, Sarita, says the woman sat up like Lazarus. She was dazzled, she claims. I looked across the bed at this beautiful senior medical student, and here's the key. I said, would you like to go downstairs and see the x-rays? And she did, and we got engaged 3 weeks later. And last week at the American College of Surgeons, the presidential address wasn't the most important lecture I gave. The most important lecture I gave was that a woman surgeon, Lee Neumeier from the University of Utah, asked Sarita and me if we would give a lecture to the residents. There were about, not this many, but 500 residents, about how to have 40 years of a happy marriage. And they said, in Sarita's case, not only being married to a surgeon, but having had a mother as a surgeon. So it is a success story. This is really the only data I'm going to show. This may be a bit of an overestimate as it's gone on, but it's directionally correct. And that is that if you look at the supply and demand of, and not just doctors, but healthcare professionals, which you today represent, how many of you are pre-med? So many. And how many are in other pre-med healthcare professions? Good. So So wherever you are, we are going to have a shortage. We're going to have a shortage of physicians. That Buzz Cooper from the University of Pennsylvania has estimated, no matter what we do, new medical schools, thank God we have a new medical school in California, we need more, we need to train more doctors, but we're not going to have enough. So what is the message here? You, as pre-med and as pre-health professionals in healthcare, you are needed. You are absolutely needed. Never let anybody tell you different. I know it's tough, I know it's competitive, I know you gotta do the MCATs and you gotta get an A in organic chem, but you are needed, and I hope to God our admissions committee are smart enough to look at you not as the underrepresented in medicine, but as those who should ultimately be represented because of your diversity, because of the passion that I feel that you have. And you must be involved, and you clearly are people who get involved just as you are today. There's a Confucian proverb which I think is very important, and that is, tell me and I will forget, show me, I may remember, but involve me and I will understand. You must be involved. Well, I concluded my presidential address with a call to action, and I had four calls to action, and I just want to mention two today. Access. Again, Dr. Guz, you used this. I don't talk about health care reform. We beat that to death. We do have the Affordable Care Act. We have legislation, thank God. We can no longer afford health care the way it's delivered today. We can no longer afford to spend 20% of the 17, 18, 19, 20% of the gross domestic product on health care. And we, you, when you become physicians and healthcare professionals, it's we who must diminish the cost of healthcare. Does anybody know what the most important or most expensive piece of technology is today in medicine? You know, we think MRI, we think CAT scanner, we think robotic surgery, but the real answer is it's the physician's pen. Because you, as physicians and as healthcare professionals, you write for the MRI and the robotic surgery and the very expensive 16th generation antibiotics when a first generation might do it, et cetera. So the first area I looked at was access to healthcare and looked at the barriers. We talk about the barriers to access to healthcare being gender. We know there's data to support that, being race. We know there's data to support that. But sometimes we forget there are other barriers to access to care, and particularly if we think globally. Things like geography. The rural surgeons in America tell me it isn't that the ranchers in my community in Wyoming don't have insurance, it's that they can't get to health care in a blizzard in the middle of the winter or across the plains of Saskatchewan. So there is that. There is a shortage, as I've just said, of physicians and healthcare professionals. And more importantly, there is a maldistribution. I did a study and looked at the distribution of surgeons, and we tend to be bi-coastal. We're heavily on the East Coast, heavily on the West Coast, and if you make it blue and red, the center of the country is red. And it also correlates with the highest death rate for motor vehicle crashes. So we have to do something about that. L.D. Britt, who is one of my dear friends, professor of surgery, University of East Carolina, and L.D., who grew up in Norfolk, Virginia, his parents were teachers. L.D. went to Harvard Medical School. He is the first African American to be president of Southern Surgical Association, et cetera, et cetera. But mostly he is a fabulous person. And LD said this, because we're talking about quality and quality of healthcare and quality indicators and measuring quality, all of which is absolutely critical and important. But LD pointed out, there is no quality without access. So we've got to make sure that there is. And we've got to make sure that we create a sustainable healthcare system. It's got to be sustainable. There's only one equation that I'll share with you, which is the value equation, where value equal quality divided by cost. If you don't know it, remember that, because value is what the patient sees. And then we've got quality, and we've got cost. The good news in that equation is that we now know that if most instances, if you increase quality, you decrease costs. So if we look at the Affordable Care Act and the recommendations, we need to follow those. We need to improve quality, and we will help take the cost out. It can't be a political decision. And I will say to you what I said to the surgeons. We must, as healthcare professionals, be absolutely forceful about speaking out about healthcare policy, because we shouldn't leave it to others. My organization has forever been a no organization. College of Surgeons was against the entitlement to acts. They've been against this and against that. And I feel strongly we've got to be front and center, speak loudly. And I just have one axiom, and that is that if we remember that it's really easy, and that in matters political, if you just stop and say, what's best for my patient, you're never going to be wrong. It's not that complicated. And then finally, I'll say a few words about internationalism. The College of Surgeons, from its very beginning, was meant to be a world fellowship, and yet we have become insular, and now we are expanding again. Sure, some of you have read this book by Thomas Friedman, where he coined the term, which we all now use, that the world is flat. And I would just add that it's getting flatter with cellular technology, with the cloud. And I thought about this. Dr. Goose, with your comment that there are more cell phones than toilets or toothbrushes in the world. Now, given what you've taught me about toilets today, I guess I should put toilets up there with cell phones, because that's part of the digital world. But we've really, and you've got a great advantage, because you are more, I mean, I hope you were proud that I had my iPhone. I know how to do the camera. I've already sent the image to my wife. I will, as soon as I sit down, to my daughter in New York, to my sons in Jackson Hole, Wyoming. I am somewhat connected. I tweet occasionally. As president of an organization, you've got to be careful about what you tweet, because for obvious reasons. So one of my other great heroes, friends, is Dr. Haile DeBass, who is chairman of the Department of Surgery at the University of California, San Francisco, went on to become chancellor, and now is the director of the Global Health Institute. And I know from our dinner last night, there are some of you in medical school who are interested in global health, and God bless you. Please carry the torch of global health, and never forget what Haile said, that we should have a diplomacy of health. I mean, I wish he were running for president of the United States, because I think if we had a diplomacy of health in this country, that it would really be much easier than some of the things we are talking about and arguing about. So finally, two stories about internationalism in a very different way. And this is reach out and be part of the world. Respond in times of disaster. I was fortunate enough to take a team to Haiti after the January 12th earthquake. And it was one of the most inspiring. After all these years as a trauma surgeon, I thought I really understood trauma. I'd seen trauma. But until I got to Hospital Saint-Francois in downtown Port-au-Prince, where the stench of death was so great that you had to wear a mask just to go, and there were no buildings. You see in the upper left of my first case, you know, here I am, this surgeon. I said, where's the scrub sink? And that was the scrub sink. You see the patient rooms. And the picture on the lower left with the ambulance, the collapsed building in the background was the pediatric ward, a four-story building that had collapsed. And there were 200 to 300 bodies of children, nurses, parents, families entombed. And we got there on post-quake day 12. So again, the stench of death was overwhelming. But, and in the lower right, you see Steve Shackford, one of my colleagues from San Diego, Scripps, and myself. In the middle in pink, you see Tom Scalia and Sharon Henry from Maryland Shock Trauma. So I'd never operated with Sharon or with Tom Scalia or with Steve, and yet we came together in Haiti and we were able to do some good. But that that's not the important thing. What we realized, we can't just go, help, leave. We've really got to set up a program through the College of Surgeons, which we are, to continue to be there to help train the surgeons. And finally, my last story really has to do with war. Virtually everything we know in trauma surgery, my field, not everything, but most things have been unfortunately learned in war. Civil War was interesting, where there were 65,000 deaths, but the vast majority were not due to wounds, they were due to infectious disease. And then we learned about transportation, MASH. Certainly, if any of you have seen MASH, really told us all about helicopter transport and so forth. Vietnam was where helicopters really made a difference. And what we learned, Vietnam, Korea, World War II, the chance of surviving an injury in war was directly proportional to diminishing the time from injury to definitive care. And my major thrust in life in the College of Surgeons has been to not just create trauma centers, but to create systems of trauma care to ensure that if you're injured, that you get to the appropriate level of care. Sometimes that's your local hospital, but often you need to be transported to a higher level of care. I'm helping set up a trauma system in India and in Brazil and in Greece. And guess what? The problems are all the same. An injured patient is an injured patient is an injured patient. Now, I don't know if Dr. Goose knows this or not, but we really all started as surgeons, as trauma surgeons. If you look at the word iatros, was first mentioned in Homer's Iliad. You've all read Homer's Iliad. At least you'll say you have when you have your your interviews. And tell your interviewers, yes, I've read Homer's Iliad, and iatros, the word for physician, means remover of arrows. So I went to Landstuhl, Germany, which is the regional medical center, as you see mapped here, where the wounded warriors, as they describe them, from Iraq when I was there, now Afghanistan, are taken care of initially downrange in the battle zone, and then they're transported to Landstuhl, Germany. This was a 1,000-bed hospital that Hitler built for his army, and the United States occupied it during the war, and it's now one of our major military hospitals. And then on to the continental United States, to Bethesda if you're a Marine, to Walter Reed, they're now combined if you're a soldier, and if you're burned, to the Brooke Army Medical Center in San Antonio. The flying ICU is a revolution. I spend the whole time talking about this, where our wounded warriors are transported in these flying ICUs with one-to-one or one-to-two care of a doctor, a nurse, a respiratory therapist. And let me conclude by telling you about William Gatsby. The night I got there, I was going to get a good night's sleep, start working the next day. They said, why don't you come over, because we have a C-17 coming in with 20 or 30 casualties. One of them has a bad vascular injury, and we know you've written about that. You're interested in vascular. Would you be willing to come over? We know you just got here. And I said, sure. So I go over, and William Gatsby, and by the way, I have permission from William, from the general, from the United States Army to share this case. And so William is wheeled in, and he's had his right leg blown off above the knee. He's got an injury to the major artery of his left leg and multiple other injuries. And they wheel him into the operating room, and I met William Gatsby, and I walk up to him, and I said, and you just called him Marine. I said, Marine Gatsby, you're shaking uncontrollably. Are you cold? And before he could answer, one of the senior military surgeons said, he's not cold, Eastman, he's frightened. I thought, oh my gosh, I've got a lot to learn here. I said, I'm sorry, are you frightened, Corporal Gatsby? He said, no, sir, I'm not frightened. I haven't been frightened since I was bleeding to death in the kill zone. I'm cold, could you get me a blanket, please, sir? And I knew we were gonna be friends. He was wounded, he was hit by an IED. Everybody else in his squad was killed, except the corpsman who crawled in under fire, put tourniquets on him, and saved his life. And remember his name, Kyle Bourgeoisie. He went to a forward surgical unit, which is a tent with a surgeon, anesthesiologist, a nurse, a few people, and they did a completion amputation. He then went to Balad, where a very good vascular surgeon fixed his left superficial femoral artery, and within 23 hours, he was in Landstuhl, Germany. I found out later that he had received the last rites in Iraq, and in fact was featured in this article in Reader's Digest, sent to me by his mother, who you'll find out I subsequently met. This was the night I met Corporal Gatsby. His right leg had been amputated above the knee. I had to open that SFA, superficial femoral artery, and redo that anastomosis. And he said, "For God's sake, whatever you do, Dr. Eastman, save my left leg, because I want to go back and be a Marine again. And I can't, if I'm a bilateral amputee, I can if it's unilateral." Corporal Gatsby survived and came to San Diego for rehab. I got a call one day from Admiral Hunter, who said, "Dr. Eastman, we have a Marine here who says that you're his surgeon." And she said, "I don't understand that." I said, "Well, I briefly took care of him in Landstuhl, Germany." She said, "Well, he wants you to come and see her." I went and saw him. His mother was there. She took the picture. And then I got this email 2 years later. And this, to me, said everything. She said, "William wanted me to let you know, Dr. Eastman, he still thinks I'm the one who saved his life. He doesn't realize," and I don't dissuade him. I say, "Yes, that's true." So many surgeons, so many corpsmen, so many pilots were involved in him, and 60 or 70 and now probably 80,000 similar casualties. But she said he met his wife while hiking in the Sierras, and their baby is going to be born on July 21st, exactly 2 years to the day when William was hit by the IED in Iraq. And then William sent me a picture of Kyle and came to my lecture when I gave the Scudder oration, and he and I thanked the military surgeons. And I said, privately, I said, "William, I kind of thought you'd name him Brent." And he said, "Sir, we discussed that, but we actually decided that Kyle, who was the corpsman who put the tourniquets on and saved my life, was more important than you." So I said, "Yes." And one other thing happened that day. He came up after the lecture. He said, "Dr. Eastman, sir, my wife and I have a problem." And I thought, oh, no. He said, "The problem is we both want Kyle to be a surgeon like you, but I think he ought to go in the Marine Corps for 4 years. She thinks he ought to go right to medical school. What do you think?" He's 2 years old. I said, "William, I have to say, I agree with you. I think he ought to be a Marine for 4 years. If he develops the strength of character that it's going to take to be a good doctor, and then go to medical school." And he said, "Well, will you write a letter of recommendation?" And I was—I felt very young that he, or at least he was a bad mathematician and hadn't figured out. So you know what? I've written a letter of recommendation for Kyle Gatsby, and it's in my file. And when he applies for medical school, I hope it helps his chances of getting in. And this is the main thing about that: is Brigadier General Rubenstein came over to. From Heidelberg to Landstuhl, thanked me for coming. And we had a long discussion, but he said something as a general in the Army that I'll never forget. He said, "You know, Brent," I was saying how much I've learned being here in Landstuhl and operating on people like Gatsby. And he said, "Just remember, as the Mayo brothers said after World War II, the only victor in war is medicine." So I thought about how to conclude, and I'm going to conclude this way, that my greatest wish for all of you here today is the absolute joy of a life in medicine that has been mine. This is Franklin Martin operating. There's music. There isn't music. We tried it yesterday and there was music. Can you please go back to the beginning of the music? I really want you to hear this. Thank you very much.